did you do with Marnie?
She's on the cutting room floor.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the cutting room floor. I'm your host, Dylan Cloud, and joining us today again is Mr. Ghost Tim Wagstaff. Welcome, sir.
Welcome.
Yes, we're here again.
It's been a little bit since we did the Scream 1 guide, so I figured it's time to go ahead and get part 2 underway, and it's helpful that I actually have the masks this time, and I don't have to solely rely on you.
Oh, I do love your wit. Why can't there be more, Dylan Cloud?
I don't think the world could handle it. I think the universe might explode. But yeah, I was someone who thought that, you know, there were Gen 2s in Scream 1. And then I realized, you know, by the time that that movie had started and finished, there wouldn't have been time for Fun World to have gotten around to making the Gen 2s. Although they probably were, you know, in the process of doing so.
Yeah.
But for people who don't know, you know, the Gen 1 mold was, what, 5 years old by the time that this original Scream came out. Mm. And to kind of keep up with the anticipated demand that these masks were going to have for being in the movie, they created, you know, what we now know as the Gen 2 by, you know, essentially recasting the first one.
Mm. Yeah, I don't know. It makes I'd always like to know a definite date when, you know, the Gen 1 sort of phased off and the Gen 2s really came in. But, yeah, with regards to the films, at least we can define a bit easier with the films by looking on screen, and screenshots, pausing it, etc., you know, what is what. So, yeah, what you got there today? I mean, I've got a couple of Scream 2-related items, but we are here about the masks. So bring up some masks onto the screen. What we got to go over?
So right here, this is a cotton shroud. This one's a polyester shroud, the same material they use today. Same mold, same type. Slightly different variations just because one of them has been hair dryer and the other hasn't, but they're very similar to a Gen 1. There are a couple of features you can look for. If you can kind of see the crease in the mouth right there.
Yeah.
And the divot at the bottom of the chin.
Yeah.
Right here.
Mm-hmm.
Just, and of course the eyes, I believe all the eyes on the Gen 2s are machine cut, so they're more symmetrical.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why you'll see some EUs sometimes that kind of look like Gen 2s.
True. And even EU stamps came with a droop hood as well, or the deluxe hood, or whatever people want to call it. But yeah, true. But you can always tell the Gen 2, can't you?
Oh, absolutely. But the cotton shrouds and the poly is, you know, now I've always been a bit confused. Now, it seems to be the current state of thinking is that Scream 2, at least for the killers, wore only cotton shroud masks.
You know what, I think unless you was on set, then we wouldn't really properly know. I mean, I've asked RJ about this in the past. I say, look, you know, what do you remember? And, you know, he says, you know, this was 20-odd years ago. You know, it's a bit hazy. So when it comes to the hood material, I honestly don't know what to think. I mean, at the end of the day, what I was always told was there was a 250 amount sent to the set. Obviously, they knew they had the cinema screen. And, you know, that big, massive scene to do there. And, of course, there's mixes of masks in there with the RDSs as well. But when it comes down to specifics such as the materials, it's I don't think anyone was really sort of taking any notice. And I don't know how much the crew on the film at the time was modifying them, if they were modifying the hoods, or whether they're just leaving the hoods and then doing, you know, modifications inside the mask for particular looks. I know Wes would like, you know, particularly looks of particular masks, just like collectors do. You know, you can look for a peg of masks and someone will pull out one and someone will pull out the other saying they like the look of them. But yeah, to say, oh yeah, all the killer masks were this shroud or that shroud, it's a bit hard to try and define unless you can actually get a decent screenshot and pause it right and, you know, check your local Blu-ray if you got one.
Well, I mean, really, at the end of it, the molds are exactly the same.
Mm.
So unless you're super nitpicky about the hood when you're wearing it, no one would know the difference.
Yeah.
But I'm glad you brought up the 250 set to set, because those particular masks had a different vinyl mix than did the other ones.
Mm.
So the way I understand it, and depending on who you ask, there were anywhere from 250 to 500 made, many sent to set, many sent just out to stores. But the main difference is, so I'll have the the standard fearsome here, which would have meant it came on a fearsome faces tag.
Hmm.
Cotton's likely would have came on a fantastic faces shroud or tag.
Yeah.
So if I take this one, just the standard regular version, I hold it by the chin. Of course, it's got some flex in it, but not too much.
Yeah.
And if I put my hands in it, you can't see my hand through the vinyl like you can the eyes. Now, if I take this one, which I believe to be a production run for Scream 2, whether or not it was on set or in store, I'll never know. But I hold the chin limp as a freshly boiled noodle. And if I put my hand in it.
Yes, you can see a bit.
You can see my finger moving around in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then
you see it.
You'll see, I hope you can see it, this mold scarring along the sides here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So those are some things to look forward to, or not forward to, but look for on your masks and kind of see it on the other side there too.
Mm.
But I think these are more or less, these were just guides for the hood to be stitched on, and sometimes they just didn't line up. But because they're so thin, a lot of times, like on the eye right here, it doesn't show up too well on camera, but you'll get this browning around the eyes where the glue is because it's so thin.
Yeah.
And you'll see a lot of these copies that they weren't taken really good care of, like this one was. You'll see the whole thing will just turn brown around the eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Whereas this one, you know, it's in a much better shape.
Much better, and you can hardly see anything around the eyes either, Some, that I don't know, I'm guessing collectors just store them differently over the years, and even non-collectors store them even worse. Some of them that's painful to look at is when you see the massive browns around the eyes, and you think, God almighty, where's that been? And then they've almost turned like a yellowy mustard bloody colour because, you know, again, probably not a collector that owned it. But, the thinness has always been in question with other fans. And I don't know, it's hard to speculate and say for definite that any fan that's just got a thinner Generation 2 or a later Fearsome, you know, is a screen user one. That's the problem where you say, well, we can assume this, but we can never guarantee it. But aside from that, of course, we also had the RDSs too, which was RDS was just one of four MK stamps. So, RDS lookalike, RDS itself, and then the squinty, and then another squinty that is hardly ever seen with a bigger gap between the bottom of the nose and top of their mouth. But you got the RDSs there, haven't you, with the MK?
Yeah, so if you look on the chin of any MK stamp mask, you'll see right here it just means it's an MK because it came from a particular factory. That's all these stamps mean, HN, T stamp, whatever. So, you know, people have dubbed this particular MK the Randy Death Scene. This one's a poly shroud. The one in the movie was a cotton shroud. Mm-hmm. Those will usually have the Fun World division on the bottom. This one says Easter Unlimited, but the mold is the same. So again, for display purposes, it fits the bill. But you can just see this was another one that was made by different factories, sculpted, you know, as best as they could to try to match, you know, what they were going for, just to meet demand. Yeah. But this wasn't just used in the Randy Death Scene. It's also, you'll see it in the opening.
In the cinema.
In the cinema, you'll see some people running around in the theater wearing these.
Mm.
There's actually a display, I believe.
Yes.
With a poster or something where standee. You can see this mask. The standee. I think,
in fact,
if you check out Douglas's video about it, I think he has a replica standee of that.
Let me show you the knife that's in relation to that as well. This is a Clive Barzilia Burt Bench knife, but this is, again, as on the standee. Hang on. Yeah. Let me just get my headphones back. But this is the... This was basically based off the standee. I mean, this is a single screenshot for the most part, but this is the knife. Again, this has got no edge on it. You can, doesn't do anything. But it's got like this more of a polished effect around the edge, and then duller in the middle, which is what Clive's managed to do here. And it's obviously your same book 120, or even 119, depending. Main handle. But he's basically holding it like that. And anybody with half a brain can even look at that standee and just say, RDS. But that's why they would have a knife like that on a stab mill, movie, I don't know. But It is what it is, and a couple of fan replicas exist because of it. But yeah, RDS's cinema scene, and poor old Randy as well. He got to meet one, didn't he?
And I'll throw a graphic up on the screen of the other MKs, but they're, for the most part, they're all very distinguishable. There's the big eye MK that a lot of people have. It's very elongated. The eyes are very, and the mouth is very exaggerated. There's the oddball one that, like you said, doesn't pop up very much.
Yeah.
And then there's the RDS lookalike, as it's been called. It's very similar to this one.
Yes.
But if you're looking at it, you can tell that it's not the same.
Yeah, with the RDS lookalike, it's almost, instead of the eyes being curved and smooth as they go up from bottom to top, it's almost like there's a stop and then it carries on again rather than being a full smooth curve. But RDS lookalikes do exactly as described. They do fool people on first occurrence and then you got to look again. But the RDS mainly got his little pig snout nose as well with a nice curved top on it. You'll see on your mask there. But yeah, all these little daft differences. But as you say, if you get images on the screen of a lookalike and an RDS, you see the differences. But yeah, there you go.
No, just side by side, you know, the nose, like you said, that pig nose, the mouth is skinnier, almost like a reshoot.
Yeah.
The eyes are, you know, farther apart and thinner.
Yeah. But yeah, they're always further apart on the RDS. It's very strange. Most figures that have come out, you know, always look like RDSs in some respect, just because of the eye spacing. But yeah, but also, yeah, during the Scream 2, I mean, you had your mask, but you also had your dodgy little blades as well, which were reptile weapons, as many people will know. Again, you know, Douglas has put information out there. There's many fans know this now. But yeah, all these little blades. I mean, this is a Clive Burt bench mask. This is a Ryan Mr. Hills. But yeah, you imagine being in that screening when they were filming. All right, you're going to be an extra. Just put this cloak on, put a mask on. Just go mad when you see people erupt. Okay.
I wish I could have just been around to raid the costume bin when they were done.
Yeah.
But RDS came on a bunch of different tags. You know, they came on Fearsomes. I think some have been found on Fantastics.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very strange that the MK molds... it's very weird to think of the duration of from when they started and finished life, because it seemed to be a really strange time in a really short time. But to say that, yeah, there's proof out there of one existing on a Fantastic tag and many others, of course, on alternate tags, of course, Fearsomes as well. It's really weird. I'm not sure if we've ever seen an RDS on an ASIS tag, whether a black one or the purpley pink ones. But I'd love to know the time frame. Yeah, I don't know. It's weird, but I'd love to know the time frame if we could ever find out. You know, of all these molds and masks, and you know. Like RDS, it was out there from 93 to 97 or something, you know, just as a random guess or something.
I would imagine, I mean, it had to be somewhere between 97 and 2000. You know, that would had to have been its you know, lifespan, because they weren't, like you said, they haven't really been found on ASIS tags, and they came out late 90s, early 2000s.
Yeah, it's just weird.
It just seems they made a lot of them at the time, because there's... a fair amount of them out there. You know, there's a lot of MKs, there's a lot of RDSs, so they really ramped up production of them.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess it was, as RJ said on the video, they noticed straight away, you know, the demand from previous, demand from when the films have come, you know, and Ghostface is well known. I can only imagine it probably went from a couple of factories to almost a dozen factories, just at a random guess. But yeah.
Now, did MKs or the RDS, did they ever come with costumes? So I've never heard of it. I've seen HNs come.
HNs, yeah. Even Oddballs, even there. I'm not sure about Oddballs, actually. Yeah, they did. Of course they did. Why? Well, because I personally own a Bibstyle RDS, and Bibstyle is normally... come in costumes, although I can't prove mine came from a costume. But I do have a Bibstyle RDS, come to think of it. See if I can pull it out here. I'm just thinking, yeah, because of course there must have been, because I've got that mask tied. It's here somewhere. Oh, God. Come on. I know you're there somewhere. Here we go, here you go. Just, that'll sit on there. But yeah. So this, I think this was a trade with Carrie Ann, as in Screen Fan 1990. But yeah, there's a, and this is cotton as well. This isn't poly. This is a cotton bib.
I've never seen a cotton bib style before.
Yeah, cotton bib. This,
that's cool.
Yeah, I guarantee you that is not poly. But yeah, there he is.
Send it on. Put it in the box.
Send it on. And we got some focus on this as well. But yeah, bib style RDS.
Does that say Easter Unlimited or Fun World on the bottom?
Easter Unlimited Inc. Made in China.
Now that's interesting.
Why is that?
Because usually you associate Cotton Shroud with having the Fun World division stamp on it, and there have been some RDSs that do have that, but that just shows how long the transition period or just material lying around.
Yeah, this is what
that's
I mean.
That's why it's so hard.
Yeah.
That's why it's so hard to date things just based on the material it's made of.
Yeah.
Unless it's been reshrouded, which is very unlikely.
Yeah, looking at the stitching on this, I would definitely say the highly unlikely matches up. This is not a restitched. This does have, a bit like the Fantastics, this does have tick marks. So the little tick mark is one here. There's one above here where the strap goes. So tick marks at either side where the strap goes. And there's even one just at the very top there, you can just see, just above my finger. So again, tick marks are probably thought of and most likely was a guide as where to cut, etc. And to where the top center of the mast should be as well. But yeah, very strange that this exists as it does, particularly because of the cotton. But yeah, this is just like as many people used to describe, like an old t-shirt. But again, more mystery with regards to Ghostface and the types and the molds and the variants. And yeah, but I honestly think, even though this didn't have a bag of its own, so to speak, this is possibly from a costume. But I don't know,
Ghostface always surprises us.
He does always surprise us. I said the same thing to RJ. I said the same thing to many other fans. You think you've got everything down. You think you've got all information covered, possibly. And then something like this pops up, and you're like, what the hell? And even some of these oddballs. There was an oddball pops up online the other day, which looked to be a mix of a Generation 2, maybe Fearsome, but also it had a T-stamp mouth. And a T-stamp mouth cutout and a T-stamp mouth paint job. So it's like, what the hell? You know, what the hell did they do with these masks at some point? Why all these weird molds and sort of mixed molds, you know? I don't know. But there
you
go.
Me and Tim always preface these videos with, this is just the best information as we have it right now. We're not like other knobs that'll say, oh, this is what it is, 100%, and then 2 weeks later change the information.
I don't think you can ever fully clarify anything with Ghostface. I mean, with recent masks, you can. You're like, you know, HHN information's out there. RJ can update us. You know, Ultra White's been around since 2011. All the same mold, apart from a hole in the bottom of the chin when the plastics came out 2017. But you know, recent masks, you can define more and find out a bit of information easier. Vintage masks, as in RDS, Gen 1s and Gen 2s, and yes, HNs, MKs, all the rest of it. Ns, you know, Ns still a mysterious mask. It's like, God, you know, what were they doing? What were they doing in them factories? Was it just simply demand more moulds? Yes, we'll approve that mould. Yes, okay, make it. Bibs, cotton, polys, you know, tag it with this, tag it with that. Did it really matter? I think as long as they was getting them out the door, you know, sell, sell, sell. Well, the demand
I think the best way to describe it would be what RJ said in your interview with him, is that Fun World is, and probably at the time was, one of, if not the largest generic costume suppliers out there. So especially when one of those costumes is in a major motion picture and the following year is in another one, you're going to get as much supply as you can because you know the demand's going to be there.
Yeah.
So they're going to go with 5 or 6 different factories, and you'll get variations and all this other stuff, and you'll get tags on different stuff. Because I've always said, you know, if one Fun World factory in 2000 just came across a box of Gen 1s that had been sitting in the closet. They're going to tag them and sell them. Or if they come across a box of tags that, you know, are old, but, you know, Ghostface has always had the same item number. They're just going to tag them and use them and sell them.
Yeah, true. Always been 9206. Yeah. 9207s for any fluorescent as well. Any fluorescent. But, yeah, I don't know. It's... If only you was a fly in the wall in one of these factories, eh? But, you know, end of the day, you could have ended up being swatted. But the point is, the vintage ones can continue to keep us guessing for the foreseeable future. But with regards to Scream 2, it does appear that, yes, for whatever reason, some thinner masks were probably used. And it's just, I don't know, I think sometimes just track down the people that got some of these Scream 2 on-screen masks and just see what details they come out with, as in Nate, you know, and whoever else that could pop up in the future. But yeah, at least for the most part, we know, as of time of recording, the main sort of masks were Generation 2s and RDSs with regards to the film. But yeah, I'd love to know what they did to the hoods, if they did modify anything. But, you know, it's that long ago now, isn't it? Yeah, those two beauties. It's weird that some of the Gen 2s, or even Fearsomes or whatever, some of them have a very, very noticeable crease in their mouth, and others just have like a faint crease in their mouth, you know. So these moulds must have took a hammering at the time. Really, really took a big hammering. But you can prominently see in the cinema scene before Maureen's killed, you can see the scar down the side of the mask, just as he's waiting to pounce, so to speak, as well. I think this is good where the Blu-rays come in, you know, because you can zoom in and have a look. Yeah, there's your scarring. Yeah. But yeah, more likely, as other fans suggest, it's just a guide as where the shroud should be covering. So, you know, some Gen 2s do have them covered as well, don't they? You have to look underneath to see them.
Yeah, mine right here does.
Yeah, is that all the same? Yeah.
So you can see it.
Ah, okay. So that's...
On that side.
Yeah, see
but
one
side. On that
side,
you can't.
The other's completely covered. Is it underneath on the other side? Yeah, is it still intact underneath?
Yeah, if you peel it back a little bit, you can see it.
Oh, I see it, yeah. Yeah. My God. These masks, they just keep you guessing. They just keep you guessing.
And again, since, you know, you're not there when this happens, you don't know if it was mold scarring or shroud guide, because, you know, trying to look on the RDS, I don't see any lines like that. But again, it would have been an entirely different factory.
Exactly, exactly. It'd have been a totally different location. Their own set of moulds, they'd have had a certain amount to pump out for the orders, and that's all they would have done. And whether it had been this tag, that tag, or even in a costume package, depending, you know, it had just been get them out the door. And then next thing you know, the containers arrive in the US, and everyone's got a mix of masks. But even the HNs as well, so there's four MKs, there's two, you know, different HN stamps on the back of those chins, and you look at them, there's noticeable differences.
But when did the vanilla smell start in the mask? Was it always there from the beginning?
I'm sure it was there. There are people out there with Fantastics that have got the smell on them. Of course, you know, over time the smell's dissipated and long gone because of the age. But yeah, there are still, as far as I know, people out there today that have got some of these rare Fantastics and there's still a vanilla smell on them. Yeah,
because none of these smell, and I don't know if like the MKs or the HNs or any of those would have even had it at all.
I think a couple of them did, and I'm sure a couple of my HNs and maybe an MK did have some smell. The what was it, the black and red tag squinty MK always had a lot of smell. That was one of the most frequent ones we saw in the UK when it first started to get the mass over here in a lot of huge numbers. Also from ASIS times, I think more the purpley pinky tags rather than the black tags. But again, the black tags probably did have the smell as well. But yeah, the purple side, the purple ASIS, as we call them here, God, they absolutely reeked of vanilla. And even in my loft right now, there's a black box with some ASIS in. And all you got to do is just crack the box like this one, and poof, it, you know, it's hit you. And they're all in bags, and yet it still hits you. Is that it for your Scream 2 mask guide?
Yeah, I think we'll wrap up the Scream 2 mask guide, and then we'll get the 3 going in the not-too-distant future. I appreciate Tim for coming on to help me again, although I'm a dirty bastard who's the bane of his existence.
It's just good to have somebody that you can bounce off with comments and banter. Because some people these days, you say the wrong thing, and it's like you're physically cutting them, for God's sake. It's like, come on, a joke is a joke. So, Mr. Cloud, at least you got a sense of humour, and at the same time, you still got some decent mass as well. Plus, you're always in my favour because you own cats. So there you go. It's only because of the cats, not the mass.
Cat people are always good people.
Aye. The tolerant people as well.
For Mr. Tim, I've been Dylan Cloud, and we'll see you next time on the cutting room floor. Y'all be good.
See you later.